Good evening, everyone. Today we will discuss about mass spectrometry. Okay. This mass spectrometry, it is slightly different from all the other spectrometric techniques which we have discussed. Over here, if you see the mass, what does this mean? This means the molecular mass. Of the molecule, molecular mass of the compounds or the molecules, whatever you would say. Okay, so we analyze the molecular mass of the various compounds with this spectrometric technique. Under this technique, we will see that the molecules are bombarded with electron beams, and due to this bombardment there are generation of radicals or cations. Radical cations. Okay. And since these are charged particles, so what happens is that when they move, due to that movement, there is a generation of what do you call electrical field, and this radical cations or the radicals, when they are moving over here, when they are moving, their movement can be tuned using using an external magnetic field. Okay. So we will see the arrangement, how this happens. Okay. So if you see over here, when we have a molecule and they are bombarded with electrons, we get molecular ions which are generated. Now these molecular ions, they can be either radical cations. Okay. So the radical cations are formed from the molecular ions in such a way that they will have a positive charge, and they will also have a neutral fragment which will not have any specific charge onto it. Similarly, we can also get carbocations which appears to be M plus stuff, and over here also we get another neutral fragments. So what happens over here is that you have a sample holder wherein you have the samples which have been placed. Now the samples over here, they are placed in such a way that when they are entering the actual mass spectrum analyzer, they are initially volatilized, and the volatilized sample, they gain entry into the mass spectrometer. Okay. Now this mass spectrometer over here, it is having a pressure of approximately 10 to the power minus 7 torr, or you can say 1 micro torr. So this chamber, the whole of this is having a very high vacuum. Okay. Now, when the molecules are getting over here, so we have a cathode we have an anode. which is positively charged, right? Then we have two cathodes over here. Which are negatively charged, and the potential of the first cathode, it is lower than the potential of the second cathode. Okay. Now this anode, what it does basically is that let us talk about this part over here. So over here, what is happening is that there is an electron gun. Okay, so electron gun, it consists of cathode wires from where the electrons are being generated, and then we have an anode. Okay, what it will do, it will pull the electrons from the cathode strip towards itself. Okay, and it will not allow the electrons to wander on the other parts of the spectrometer, and this is basically, it is called the electron collector. Okay, it is basically called as the electron collector. Okay, now when you are having this electron beam from here, from the left hand side, you have the sample molecules which are coming through here, but these blue dotted lines, they are the electrons which are passing from the cathode to the anode to the electron collector. So they are moving at a very high speed. Okay, so what happens is that when this molecules passes through this region, the metal ions, these black metal ions, they are getting bombarded with the electrons from here, right? And they are getting bombarded, and they are forming, they are interacting with the electron beam, and they are forming molecular ions. Okay, as they pass out, and when they are forming these molecular ions, if you see, they are positive in charge. Okay, they are positive in charge. They are being repelled by this anode. Okay, and at the same time, what is happening, these cathodes, they are attracting it, and due to this reason, there is an acceleration of these molecular ions. And when these molecular ions, when we talk about these molecular ions, they are very unstable ions, and they then fragment to form radical cations or carbocations. Okay, so they basically form a type of the cations and another neutral fragment. Okay, and this radical, these cations, they are being they are being accelerated, and they gain a voltage. And as they come out of this region, this fragmentation chamber of the mass spectrum analyzer, a magnetic field is being it is being applied, which is having a field of 500 to 8000 gauss. Now what it does is that the magnetic field is placed in such a way that the ions, they follow a, what do you call this, they follow the, a curved path, which is having, hypothetically, which is having a radius r. Okay, hypothetically, it is having a radius r. And this radius is basically called the path of the molecular ions. Okay, this is the the functioning of the mass spectrum analyzer, and these molecular this molecular ions, they are getting detected using this detector. Okay, now when we talk about this molecular ions or the radical cations or carbocations, a molecule can break down into different cations or carbocations or neutral fragments. Okay, and when a molecule is breaking down into different different fragments, so you may have, say, fragment A, B, C, D, E, and F, say for example, where F is the neutral fragment, and all these A, B, C, D, E fragments, they are charged fragments. Now, how come these are coming? These are coming because the electrons, these electron beams, they are knocking off the molecular electrons, or they are breaking down the bonding electrons so that they can break down the what do you call they can break down the this thing. They can break down the bonds and they can release some of the atoms. And this breaking down, it may appear in different forms. Okay, that we will discuss a bit later. So when we talk, when I talked about this acceleration, this energy of the accelerated electrons, it is kept at 17 electron volt. Okay, 70 electron volt, and this results in a typical wavelength of 0.14 nm. And why this 70 electron volt acceleration is needed? It is because it generates an electron beam of which is having an what you call an wavelength of or a, sorry, a wavelength of 0.14 nanometer. Okay, now in this case, why this is important? Suppose there is a molecule of A and B. Usually the bond length between A and B, it is having the bond, this bond length, it is having a length of approximately 0.14 nanometer. Okay, and due to this reason, the electron beams, they can interact or they can have sufficient energy to break down this molecular bonds within the molecules. And due to this reason, this 70 electron volt energy of the accelerated electrons is an important thing. Okay, so the electron beam which is coming from here, they are having an energy of 70 electron volt. Okay. So I am repeating this again. In short, so we have a sample. Within the sample holder, we have the samples. Before the sample is introduced into the mass spectrometer, they are being vaporized, and this vaporized system, they get into the mass spectrum analyzer. And over here, through a small orifice, it enters into the actual what you call fragmentation zone. And while it is entering, we have an anode and we have two cathodes. Okay, now this anode and cathodes, they are used to accelerate the radical cations or carbocations. Okay, and how they are formed? Between these two electrodes, there is an electron beam generator. Here is the electron beam generator where these cathodes which can generate the electrons, and then we have an anode which is basically the electron collector, and the voltage between these two is set such that the electrons which will be generated, they would have an energy of 70 electron volts. Okay, now the why this is important, as I said, this 70 electron volt electron beam, they have a wavelength of 0.14 nm, which is of the order of the bond length of a molecule. Okay, of a typical molecule. So that this electron beam, they can interact with this bond and they are able to break down the molecules into the different cations, the radical cations or the carbocations. Okay. Now, once this radical cations and the carbocations, they are formed, along with that, some neutral fragments, they are also formed. However, these radical cations and the carbocations, they are being accelerated within this fragmentation zone, and they enter into a region where we have a magnetic field of 500 to 8000 gauss, and that is a variable magnetic field. And depending upon this magnetic field, we will be able to we will be able to change the radius of the radical cations or the carbocations. Okay, and this radius, it is dependent on the mass of this carbocation or the radical cations. Okay, so in general, m by z, it is directly proportional to the r square. What is m by z? Mass is to charge ratio. Okay, suppose this molecular cation or this radical cation, it is having a mass of 16 and it is having two positive charge, say M2 plus radical, then we will be having mass is 16 and then divided by 2, which comes out to be 8. So the our M by Z, it would be 8, which would be directly proportional to the R square. Suppose we have this M dot plus, say the same molecule, but it has fragmented into a different way, then what will happen? Then 16 by 1. Okay, so 16 would be directly proportional to the, say the first one is R1, this one is R2 square. Okay, now what is happening? So what is the masses to charge ratio of the first one? Say capital A and capital B. First one is 8 and B is 6. So what is happening? Higher the mass, higher would be the radius. So B, it is having higher the masses to charge ratio, so it would be having a larger radius. A, it is having lower mass is to charge ratio, it will be having a lower radius. Okay, now over here, if you see the detector, it is only allowing a specific molecule or the cations, radical cations, to pass through it and get detected. In this case, the magnetic field, it is being tuned or it is changed to get the detection at different magnetic field. Okay, however, in the modern day systems, we have a system where we have a detector which is capable of detecting multiple detectors, because all of these, they are basically either CMOS detector or CCD detectors, charged coupled detectors. So just like in our previous spectrometric technique, if we apply an array, we will be able to detect the different ions within the same sensor chip. Okay, now due to this reason, along this path, along the length of the detectors, you will be able to separate all the molecular ions of different molecular weight. Okay, so what we'll be having, so from right to left, you'll be having the molecular ions, and you will be getting, depending upon which of these sensors are getting hit, you will be getting some peaks. And in molecular spectroscopy, you will get, in the y-axis, you will get relative abundance. Okay, and in the y-axis, you will be getting m by z. Okay, and quite often it is also regarded as mass. It may be replaced with mass. Ultimately, it may be related with the mass. Okay, So then you will be getting peaks like this over here, depending upon the relative this thing. So the peak on the rightmost side, it will be having the highest molecular mass, and in this way you can find out the relative abundance of different molecular of the different radical cations or the carbocations within the system. Okay, so let's see what it is over here. When a high energy electron it collides with a molecule, it often ionizes it by knocking away one of the molecular electrons. It may be either bonding electron or non-bonding electrons. This leaves behind a molecular ion which are colored red molecular ions. Now the residual energy from the collision may cause the molecular ion to fragment into neutral pieces, these green colored these things, and smaller fragment ions colored pink and orange. Okay, right, the molecular ion is a radical cation, but the fragment ions may either be radical cations or carbocations depending upon the nature of the neutral fragment. Okay, this is the whole functioning of the mass spectrum analyzer. Now let us take an example. Let me use this page. Suppose I have a propane. So how does the propane look like? CH3, CH2, CH3. Okay. Now if you see, we have two types of bond, C bond and CH bond. Now let us take up this CH bond. Now when we are generating this electron beam, and we are asking it to collide with this CH bonds, then one thing can happen. Carbon, it is having its own core electrons. Okay, so it may so happen one of the core electrons from here, it is knocked off. Okay, core electrons is knocked off. Now in that case, what will happen is that we'll be having a system CH3, CH2, CH3, since one of the which is the core electron from the carbon has been knocked off, we'll be getting a radical cation. Okay, this is one of the example. Another type of electrons in this CH bond is the bonding electrons between the C and H, and we know that both of them, they are sharing one electron. Okay, so what you may get, you can knock off one of this electron and then you will get CH3 CH plus CH3, right? So this is a carbocation, because the carbon, it has got the positive charge over here, and when it has knocked off the hydrogen, it has taken up this electron, and it has then this hydrogen atom, it is neutral atom, and it will not be affected by this magnetic field, and they will be absorbed by the walls of this systems. Okay, now we'll be getting a carbocation over here, like this one. So what is the molecular mass over here? 36 plus 3 to 5 by 38. Right? 44, yeah. So its molecular mass, it is 44. So we'll be getting some peak over here. Next thing, over here, if you see, we have a carbocation, and this carbocation, it is a secondary carbocation, okay, because it is not on the primary, one of the primary carbons, okay. What is the molecular weight over here? The molecular of weight of this carbocation is 43, right? Why 44? Minus one hydrogen atom, it has been knocked off, so we get 43. Okay. Now, the abundance of carbocations, secondary carbocations, it is higher than the normal cations or the primary carbocations. Okay. So, the relative abundance of this one over here, it will be quite larger. Okay, so you will be getting a higher peak. The first peak you got at 44, the second peak at 43. Are you getting my point? Now, we were just talking about this thing. Now, the same thing, it may happen over here at CC bond. When it is happening, the CC bond, there are two ways, CH3, CH2 carbocation plus CH3 radical, which will be formed. Okay. Now, these radicals, they will not be analyzed over here, because if you see the system, we have, it is getting its, it is getting electron deficient, and it is getting its own share of the electron, and it is going off. It is basically a neutral element. Now, this carbon, this system, it is being generated. This carbocation is being generated. Now, if you look into this carbon carbocation, it is a primary carbocation, whereas over here we are having a secondary carbocation. What we said, the abundance, the relative abundance of the secondary carbocation will always be higher than the primary carbocations. So its peak will be smaller. Okay. Similarly, we can have a system, we can have a carbocation of methane, and we will get a peak over here. So what will be this peak? This will be same, 12 plus 12, 14, 24, 24 plus 5, 29. At 29, we'll be getting this peak, and this last peak we'll be getting at 15, right? However, this CH3 carbocation peak is highly unstable, and it becomes neutralized within the environment, and within the given time of the time of flight, and within that time it may become it may be neutralized, and due to this reason, in many cases you may not obtain this methyl carbocation peaks. Okay. So this is relative abundance, this is mass. So in this way, you can get a system over here, right? Now, say for example, we have a system like, say, CH3, CH3. So, 2-methyl propane, and we have another atom or another molecule, say butane. Right? Now, how will you identify? Suppose I have given 2 spectra, mass spectra of say A and B, where A is the 2-methyl propane and B is butane, okay, N-butane. Now, how will you be able to find out which spectra is of which domain or which molecule? You have to keep in mind over here this fact which I have told you, that the secondary carbocation, they will be the most stable one. Now suppose in both of these cases, if I knock off one of the methyl group, terminal methyl group, in this case it may be this one, it may be this one also, it may be this one also. So there are chances of, there are 3 terminal groups, say 1, 2 and 3, and over here there are 2, 1 and 2 terminal, this thing. So in either of this case, if you look over here, when we are knocking off this primary methyl group, we'll be getting a carbocation, a secondary carbocation. Okay. Whereas in this case, whether you remove the first one or the second one, you will always be getting a primary carbocation. You'll be getting a primary carbocation. Okay. So what is the relative abundance? Whose relative abundance will be higher? The relative abundance, if you look into the this part, it is CH3. So what is the molecular weight? 36 plus 40, 43, 6, 7, 43. What about this one? Again, 36 plus 7, 43. At 43, in this case, both of these cases, you will be getting a peak. However, since the A molecule, which is 2-methyl propane, you are getting secondary carbocation, the mass spectra at 43 mass, you will be getting a higher relative abundance of the of this carbocation, okay, at 43 mass. Okay, so in this way you will be able to find out what is happening over here. Also you will get you can get another you can play with this removal of the hydrogen ion, the hydrogen atom and all these things, because all the possibilities has to be taken care of. So I can give you a molecule and I will tell you, draw a representative mass spectra of this molecule, say butane. So then you should be able to perform this, you should be able to find out what should be the mass spectra of this normal butane should look like. Okay. Now, coming to the electron ionization, you have the precursor, which is basically the parent molecule. We have the electron beam. So then it is being charged, these molecules are being charged, and so we have dissociative result. Okay, so we can give charge, we can get charged and neutral fragments over here. This is the charged fragment, then you have the neutral fragments which can come off, then we can have an ionized parent molecule. Okay, now scheme of the electron ionization instrument, you have the sample which is being put into the this area, then you have a repeller, and then you have the filament. Okay, electron, you have an electron trap. Electron trap is basically the electron collector, which I already discussed. Additionally, there are some magnetic field which is being applied. Now, why this magnetic field is applied? This is applied such that the since we are introducing the sample in the gaseous form, so the chances of electrons hitting the molecules, it will be quite less. So due to this reason, so if you apply a magnetic field, the electrons, it moves in a helical path. So when it is moving in a helical path, the actual path length of the electron beam, it is increased, and hence the chances of ionization of the molecule, it would increase. Then, as I said, there is a repeller. This will repel the cation molecules through the system, and then these are the these are the accelerators, and through this, when they pass in through this, and it goes to the analyzer. So this part, this is called the analyzer. Okay, so let's now discuss about the other stuff. So mass spectrometry, it is also regarded as MS. It is used to measure the mass to charge ratio of ions. Mass spectrum, it is basically a plot of intensity, which is basically the relative abundance as a function of mass to charge ratio. These spectra are used to determine the elemental or isotropic signature of a sample, the masses of the particles and of molecules, and to elucidate the chemical identity or structure of molecules and other chemical compounds. A sample, it may be solid, liquid or gaseous. The only thing is that when it enters into this fragmentation unit, it should be in the vaporized form. Okay, it is the sample is ionized, for example, by bombarding it with electrons. Okay, the samples molecules, now this may cause the samples molecules to break into charged fragments or simply become charged without fragmenting. Okay, both of these things are possible. I have told you over here, just by knocking off one of the core electrons without fragmentation, it has become a charged molecule, and in the second case, one hydrogen atom has been fragmented. Okay, these ions are then separated according to their mass is to charge ratio, and how it happens I told you. The ions are detected by a mechanism capable of detecting charged particles, such as electron multiplier. Okay, the results are displayed as the spectra by the computer. The atoms or molecules in the sample can be identified by correlating known mass to the identified masses or through a characteristic fragmentation pattern. Now, creating ions. Ions can be created. The ion source is the passed into the spectrometer, and it ionizes the material under the analysis. The ions are then transported by magnetic or electric field to the mass analyzer. Electron ionization or chemical ionization are used for gases and vapors. Two techniques often used with liquid and solid biological samples include electrospray ionization and matrix assisted laser desorption ionization. Desorption ionization, yeah, MALDI. So you will find MALDI. MALDI is quite commonly used in biological samples. Okay. MALDI TOF, you will find MALDI. Time of flight. What is time of flight? Time of flight is, as I said you, that when the molecules, they enter into this detector region or the analyzer region, according to the mass, there will be a radius. If mass is larger, radius will be larger, so it will have its own, it will stick to its own path. Okay, if mass is reduced, its length is reduced. Since radius is reduced, when mass is reduced, radius is reduced, but time of flight, it is increased. Okay, as compared to the heavier fragments, okay, heavier charged fragments. So that is that time of flight, it is being detected. Okay, so types of ionization methods, there may be hard ionization or the soft ionization. Hard ionization techniques, they impart high energy, high quantities of residual energy in the subject molecule, invoking large degrees of fragmentation. Okay, then resultant ions tend to have m by z lower than the molecular mass of the molecules. Okay, the most common example of hard ionization is electron ionization, which I have already told you. Soft ionization refers to the process which impart little residual energy onto the subject molecule and as such result in little fragmentation. Example includes fast atom bombardment, chemical ionization, atmospheric pressure chemical ionization, electrospray ionization, desorption electrospray ionization, and matrix assisted laser desorption ionization. I am interested, since we are talking about the biological samples, we are interested in ESI and MALDI. Okay. Inductively coupled plasma sources are used primarily for cation analysis of a wide array of samples. In this source, a plasma that is electrically neutral overall is used to atomize induced sample molecules and to further strip the outer electrons from those atoms. The plasma is usually generated from argon gas. And how the argon plasma is generated, we have already discussed in AES, atomic emission spectroscopy. Okay, ICP AES, inductively coupled plasma AES. So you can get the information from there. Then photoionization Meyer spectrometry, a high energy photon, either X-ray or UV, it is used to dissociate stable gaseous molecules in a carrier gas of helium or argon. Okay, I'm not going into the details of this one. I hope you are able to understand. Then ambient ionization, ions form in an ion source outside the mass spectrometry. Okay, so some applications of ambient ionization include environmental application as well as clinical applications. In these techniques, ions are formed outside the spectrometer. Sampling becomes easy as the sample don't need previous separation, not preparation. Some of the examples of ambient ionization techniques are DESI, SESI, ESI, then DAPCI, desorption atmospheric pressure chemical ionization, among the others. And other ionization techniques include field desorption, fast atom bombardment, then thermospray, then diodes, atmospheric pressure chemical ionization, TIMS, SIMS. Okay, so please look into this stuff. You are not, will not be discussing these in details, as we are interested in the biological samples, and we will look into that a bit later. Then mass analysis separate the ions according to their mass to charge ratio. You have two laws which govern the thermodynamics of charged particles in electric and magnetic field in vacuum, where F is equal to Q equals to E plus V multiplied by V, and then F equals to MA. Okay. Now from here, if you equate, we can get this thing, M by Q multiplied by A is equal to E plus V multiplied by B. Okay. Where V is the ion velocity. This is a differential equation. This differential equation is the classic equation of motion for charged particle. It completely determines the particle's motion in space and time in terms of m by q. Thus, mass spectrometer could be thought of as a mass to charge spectrometer. Okay. Now, I hope you are getting why it is called mass to charge spectrometer. It is common to use the officially dimensionless m by z, where z is the number of elementary charges on the ion, z equals to q by e. This quantity represents the ratio of the mass number and the charge number. Okay. Many mass sources use two or more mass analyzers, which is regarded as tandem mass spectrometry, which is also called MS/MS spectrometry. The mass resolving power is the measure of the ability to distinguish two peaks of slightly different m by z ratio. The mass accuracy is the ratio of the m by z measurement error to true m by z. Mass accuracy is usually measured in ppm or milli mass units. Okay. Now coming to this tandem mass spectrometry, and it is highly used in biological samples while we are analyzing the biological molecules. Okay. So what happens over here? You have the sample, then we do the ionization using ESI. ESI stands for electrospray ionization, or MALDI ionization. We do the ionization, you have the ionization, this thing, then you do the m by z separation. Okay. Now once you do the m by z separation, you get the first precursor, then you find out the first spectra, and after this spectral analysis you again undergo for CID. CID, I forgot it. Collision induced air dissociation. Okay. You go for the fragmentation using the collision induced fragmentation. Okay. And then again you do the mass spectrometry. Okay. Now in electrospray ionization, what happens? You have the samples which are being put into the system, and over here you apply a very high electrical field. This is a needle, basically. This is a micro needle, and through this micro needle, at the tip of the micro needle, you apply a very high electrical field, and under this electrical field, what you have, these molecules in the solution form, they are being put into the nebulization unit, and during this process a cone is formed. This cone is called Taylor cone. And slowly, after this Taylor cone, this droplets are formed, and during this process, due to the high voltage, the molecules, they become ionized. Okay. And this is the process of electrospray ionization. So over here, electrospray ionization is a technique used in mass spectrometry to produce ions using an electrospray in which a high voltage is applied to a liquid to create an aerosol. It is specially useful for producing ions from macromolecules, where all the biological molecules are macromolecules, whether you say the DNA, proteins, or RNA, whatever. Okay, because it overcomes the propensity of these molecules to fragment when ionized. The diagram of electrospray ionization in positive mode. Under high voltage, the Taylor cone emits a jet of liquid droplets. The solvent from the droplets progressively evaporates, leaving them more and more charged. When the charge exceeds the Rayleigh limit, the droplet explosively dissociates, leaving a string of charged positive ions. Okay. So how these positive ions are formed, it has been explained over here. Then MALDI. MALDI is basically the matrix-assisted desorption ionization. What happens over here is, basically, I will tell you in short. You have the samples which is being embedded within a region, within a matrix, and hence it is called the matrix assisted. Okay. Then the laser means we have to use a laser of high energy. So a high energy laser is used, and the samples from here, they are getting ionized from here and they are pushed into the analyzer and then to the towards the detector. So let's see over here. MALDI is an ionization technique that uses a laser energy absorbing matrix to create ions from large molecules with minimal fragmentation. We do not want the fragmentation at this stage because we will be able to have a proper understanding what is the total molecular weight or the actual molecular weight of the proteins or the DNAs, whatever. We want to have an idea about that one. Okay. It is similar in character to electrospray ionization in that both techniques are relatively soft, low fragmentation ways of obtaining ions of large molecules in gas phase, though MALDI typically produces far fewer charged ions. MALDI methodology is a three-step process. First, the sample is mixed with a suitable matrix material and applied to a metal plate. The second, a pulsed laser irradiates the sample, triggering ablation and desorption of the sample and the matrix material. Okay. Finally, the analyte molecules are ionized by being protonated or deprotonated in hot plume of ablated gases, and then they are accelerated into whichever mass spectrometer is used to analyze them. Okay. Then collision-induced dissociation. In this collision-induced dissociation, what happens? It may be either a homolytic fragmentation or an heterolytic fragmentation. Okay. So as the names suggest, the collision within the charged molecules, it only is responsible for the dissociation or the fragmentation processes. Okay. So CID is also known as collisionally activated dissociation. Is a mass spectrometry technique to induce fragmentation of selected ions in gas phase. The selected ions are accelerated by applying an electrical potential to increase the ion kinetic energy and then allowed to collide with neutral molecules, often helium, nitrogen or argon. So if you see the electron beam energy and all these things, they are not used over here. So they are being collided with the other molecules which are typically more neutral and they will not be undergoing dissociation itself, but they will induce fragmentation within the samples molecules. Okay. In the collision, some of the kinetic energy is converted into the internal energy which results in the bond breakage and the fragmentation of the molecular ion into smaller fragments. Okay. The fragmentation mechanism, as I said, there may be homolytic fragmentation. In homolytic fragmentation is bond dissociation where each of the fragments retains one of the originally bonded electrons. Okay. And heterolytic fragmentation is bond cleavage where the bond electrons remain only one of the fragmented species. Okay. Over here. Now, which one is more important? For mass spectrometry, heterolytic fragmentation is more important because we have seen that the cations, the structure of the mass spectrometry is such that the cations are being analyzed over there. So we would prefer this heterolytic fragmentation. If you have any question, please let me know. Are you guys there?
Yes, sir.
Do you guys have any question?
No, sir.